Right. So again, so kind of now that we've got a reasonable understanding, and I say, although I say reasonable understanding, I respect that it's a lot to take in. Take your time, draw up a table, replay the video to understand the logic flow. If you really want to get an understanding of this, the best thing is to actually write this down on a piece of paper and then go through without the table, go through a situation where you kind of assume at different voltage levels and then work through the logic yourself of what you expect to see out from the comparators, because then that'll give you an understanding of how they work, what input that's going to provide to the RS flip-flop, and then the expected output. And from that, you start to gain a nice understanding of how this all hangs together. From that, we understand the input and what's going to happen on the input here as the voltage level changes or stays at a certain point where it kind of is in kind of a memory mode, a memory state for the RS flip-flop. And on the output, as noted here, we're getting it from the NOT Q or the inverted side, which drives the transistor pin 7, which allows discharge to ground, or then the output, our main output pin 3, but remember it's inverted, and in theory that could come straight from pin Q. Right, so next let's have a first look at one of the practical applications and how I've got it on that circuit, where it's being used as a pulse width PWM driver for the LED, so we can adjust the brightness of an LED. In this mode, it's described as being an astable multivibrator, is the term you will come across if you are playing with 555 timers. I have got some equations down here. We're not going to get bogged down by the equations, but I just wanted them there just for a little bit of understanding once we understand the flow through the circuit and how it operates. You'll also note on this side here, we'll talk about towards the end, I've got two transistors here. I do not have my circuit configured like this, but I thought it was interesting. Again, something I haven't come across, something known as a Darlington pair, and we'll discuss that and why that configuration is sometimes used. In this circuit, at the center, we've obviously got the 555 timer. The pins I've got labeled here, obviously they're not labeled sequentially, it's as you've got them connected in the circuit. We've got pin 8, which we know is the supply, is going up to the positive rail, VCC. Pin 4, remember, is a reset. We don't want to reset this during the operation, so we've got it tied high, so it doesn't reset the circuit. We've got pin 1 down here going down to negative. This is the negative supply of VCC. Pin 5, as I mentioned before, that's the control pin, and what you should do for correctness is use a decoupling capacitor and tie that down to your ground. We've then got the output, and that I should have labeled as pin 3. So pin 3 is our output, and that is going to drive a transistor, which ultimately drives our LED. Now there's a resistor over here, and that's to limit the current being used or used to drive the transistor, which ultimately then drives the LED. Now remember, in this circuit, what we've got happening is the LED is being switched on very quickly on and off to give our eye a perception that it's constantly on. But the brightness can be varied by adjusting the amount of time that the actual LED is switched on and it's switched off. And that's what the pulse width modulation is going to do through this transistor. Now, to understanding how that timing is achieved, we're going to look at concentrate on the external componentry in the circuit, which I've got on the breadboard. On that breadboard, we've got a few resistors, a diode, and a capacitor, and these form the timing components for what is read as the voltage levels by the trigger. And in this case, again, we're tying 6 and 2 together for this implementation. So those two are tied together, and that's our voltage threshold, which comes into the 555 timer. Now, as I said, all we're trying to do here is to provide a time or voltage level, which is represented by the capacitor filling up, which once it goes through those certain thresholds is obviously going to change the state of the comparators, the RS flip-flop, and the output. Now this circuit is designed to keep the frequency the same, and the interesting part there, the frequency, as noted by this bottom equation over here, is basically 1 over the period or the time, and the components for that are derived from our naturally occurring number E. Again, if you want to know more about that, I've got a tutorial on capacitors. And then that has got a relationship with the resistors and the capacitor. Now, the frequency stays the same for the circuit because those values don't actually change if you look at it across down here. Yes, we've got a potentiometer where we vary the resistance, but this potentiometer actually changes the duty cycle of the wave. So we've got the wave and it's either in an on state or an off state. And depending on how we change the time that it switched on and the time that it switched off. And that is the duty cycle. The more time it's on will dictate that the LED switched on for longer. And then obviously the inverse of it, the more time it's off, that is switched off, the dimmer that's going to look. So the more time this is on, the LED is going to be brighter. And the more time it's off, the LED is going to be perceived as being dimmer. But that'll come out once we get to the practical exercise. Now in this circuit, we've got R1, which is noted as being 1K, R2, which is also 1K. We've then got the pot. In my circuit, I've decided to use a 100K pot. You could use a 50K pot. You can chop and change and experiment with these values to obtain different functioning of the actual 555 timer itself. That's the fun part of playing with these. In particular, when we get to the latch switch, we'll see that as well. But in this case, what we want to do is understand what happens when we apply a voltage here and how this switches. It's astable because it doesn't have a single stable state. It's switching back and forth. So when we apply VCC, we are going to get a current flowing through this resistor, R1. It's going to come through on this pot. We've split up because you've got your sweeper and the two sides of your resistor where you're sweeping. You've got two parts of resistance. You've got Rx and Ry, and I've labeled it as such. So your current is going to come through R1, then through Rx, and then we've got this diode over here which bypasses Ry, the second part of the pot. It allows an easier path for the current to flow through. So it's going to come down through here, path of least resistance, through this diode, then down, and it's going to be charging up the capacitor at this point in time. And obviously then we've got our return path through our negative. Now as we're charging that capacitor up, we've already gone through the logic. Once we start getting above a third VCC and above two-thirds VCC, we start getting the state of the circuit changing. So as this charges up, and that's dictated obviously by the resistance levels, which are going to control how quickly or how slowly the capacitor charges up, it's going to hit a point where the output is going to change. And then pin 7 becomes a low impedance path for the discharge. So as you recall, if we're going to have a look at the circuit over here, when we've got a high output on pin 3, pin 7 is going to be switched off. This transistor isn't going to be active. But when we have a change in state and then pin 3 goes low, that's because we've obviously got it going through this inverter over here. The opposite output is going to be on the actual transistor. So the transistor is going to be switched on, allowing that discharge path through pin 7 down to ground. So that means now we've got a capacitor that's been charged up, which has allowed the voltage to build up, and the input is obviously being looked at by the trigger on 6 and 2. And once it reaches that threshold, this then discharges. It comes through the capacitor, through R2, through Ry, because in this case we've got the diode there. It can't go backwards through the diode. It's going through here, and it's then got a low impedance path through pin 7 down to ground. So pin 7 actually gets tied down to ground through pin 1. And that's how it discharges. And obviously it's then discharging. It's coming down. Our voltage levels are changing, and as we noted on the input to the comparators, when it's going to hit a certain level, the logic is going to change, the flip-flop's going to change, the output's going to change levels again. And that's literally how the circuit works. It's constantly switching on and off, and that's the astable multivibrator. The equations given for the time on that wave for the on time and the off time, so you've got T on, T off, this is your period, are literally, if you go and follow the path that I've just described, these are the equations where it goes through. We've obviously got our 0.67, which is derived from E, and then we've got R1 plus Rx plus R2 times the capacitor. Again, if you go and follow the path that I just explained, and then the off time is denoted by 0.67 times by R2 plus Ry times the capacitor. Those in total obviously give you your period or T total, And obviously 1 over your period is your frequency, and that's how your frequency can be derived. And from that, if you look at it logically, the overall resistance across these components stays the same. So that's why your frequency stays the same. It's just your period, or your on time or your off time, that is changing, which is obviously changing the pulse width and thus changing how the transistor is being driven. So on the business end, what's happening as that is going on and off, this is external obviously now to the 555 timer. We've got the resistor controlling the current flow, which is biasing this transistor. Now, first of all, I'm going to explain this as I've got it set up. And in that case, you can just note that the current flow is basically going to be allowed to flow through the LED. The transistor is switched on, biased, which allows the current to flow through it and then back down to the negative. And obviously, when it switches off, things are switched off over here. But that's happening very quickly at a high frequency, and that's controlling the brightness of the actual LED itself. Now, I bring in the Darlington pair because one of the circuits I looked at had this, and I certainly didn't know what it was. And the Darlington pair, first of all, the gent was called Sydney Darlington. That's how it gets its name. He worked for Bell Labs, and in 1953, he came up with this configuration of tying two transistors together in what he called the Darlington pair. And here we've got the collector. So this is obviously the collector. That's the emitter on the transistor. This is the base. And we've got common collectors tied together. So the two collectors are tied together. And then we've got the first transistor. The emitter is driving the base of the second transistor. And then obviously we go out. And what this does, this provides you with a higher level of amplification. So this transistor is obviously going to have, is going to be driven by a small control current over here, which can drive a larger control current over here. And because you've got a larger current coming through here, you've now got a larger drive to this transistor, which can drive this one even harder. Now, there are certain downsides to this configuration, but it does allow you a nice bump up in terms of the kind of amplification or drive on this transistor. And often what you'll find, or what you need to be aware of, is that this second transistor in the pair needs to be able to carry the current that you're expecting to load it with, because it's potentially going to switch on very hard. So you want a transistor here that can handle the current for your application. But that is the Darlington pair. As I said, in my circuit, I've literally only got the one. But if you want to experiment, play around with how this works, then that is the Darlington pair. Right, so next, let's go and have a look at the latch switch, or the second circuit. Now, obviously, with the circuit example that I'm going to show in part two, this is the first part, which is driving, acting as a switch, which switches on the operation of the pulse width modulated circuit to drive the actual LED. So this is the switching part. Now, what you'll also hear, the terms you'll hear bandied around, such as monostable or one shot, in terms of the operation of a 555 timer. And there you can have the 555 timer where it operates, where it's got two stable states, as opposed to flicking between a high and a low on your output. Here with the latch switch, it's either going to be sitting stably at a high or a low state, or you can have it configured as a one shot, where basically when you fire the circuit, it goes high for a little amount of time, which is determined by your timing components, and then comes down back low again. So it's got one single stable state, but it switches up and will come back down to that state depending on the timing components. Right, so the overall operation of this little latch switch is as follows. We've got the 555 timer at the heart of it, and again, I've got all the pins labeled. We've got, again, pins 6 and 2 tied together because they're acting as our trigger. In this case, we're not using pin 7, the discharge. And we've got pin 8 supplying VCC, pin 1, the negative of VCC, pin 3 is the output, pin 4 is being tied up to the positive of VCC because we don't want the circuit to reset. And here I've noted with a question mark, and I am operating the circuit like that. We've got the control pin, pin 5, is not attached. But as I said, proper practice to ensure you don't get any issues, you want to tie that down with a decoupling capacitor down to ground. So what's happening here in this transistor, we'll look at the kind of back end of it first. again, we've got the output from pin 3 is going to control a transistor, which is acting as our switch, electronic switch. We've got a 1K resistor at the base of that. That's merely to control, so you're not, you're controlling the amount of current when you're driving the transistor. And that literally, I've got over here the open circuit, because this is where I connect the supply to the next circuit, the pulse width modulated circuit. So when this switch is on, my the second circuit is then supplied with the power it needs. And when this is switched off, then the LED is actually switched off. So it is literally just acting as a switch. We then over here have an LED. There's a little red LED you'll have noted, which comes illuminates, and that has got a little 330 ohm resistor to control the current flowing through it so you don't blow it. And that is literally tied to the output so that when the output goes high, it is driven and it shows you that you've actually got the circuit switched on. So if I didn't have anything attached here, I can logically see what's going on the circuit. You obviously don't need to have this. This is just a merely an indicator of what's happening on the circuit. Right, so now we get round to the timing side of it. We've got VCC, we've got a momentary switch. This is that little black push switch which I've got. We've got a voltage divider here on the input trigger. And then we've got our timing device, if you will. We've got a 100K resistor over here, and then we've got a 4.3 microfarad capacitor. I've got a question mark there because you can change the value of that. And as you'll see, depending on that value, you can kind of functionally change how this latch switch works. There's a few little quirks, but if you have a value of anywhere between, let's say, 1 and 10 microfarad, you probably get an operation that works well, but you can fine tune that, and we'll do that when we get to the practical example. Now again, the basis for the operation of this circuit is that what's going to happen is that the input to your volt trigger is going to be determined by the voltage that's across the capacitor over here. So here we've got our trigger input. The voltage level from the transistor will determine whether that's a high or a low. And then depending on our voltage level at the input here, the state of the output is obviously going to change. But we want this not to kind of flick-flack back and forth. We want it to be stable and remain in a certain state that we put it in, either high or low, because it's going to act as a latch switch. So that's why I said that understanding that kind of memory state of the flip-flop is important, because in some of this, many of the circuits that I looked at on a latch switch, they didn't kind of describe that, and that's important. And that is done by these two voltage dividers over here. Right across VCC, I've got a 10K and a 10K, and this is going to be interesting. These are the actual resistor values that I took from a several circuits that I looked at online. There's something interesting about these values, which you'll note again when we get to the practical exercise. So because this is a voltage divider, we are going to have half the voltage sitting here by default at the trigger from our VCC. So that's going to be roughly around 3 volts. And if you recall, at 2/3 VCC, we're going to have one state. When we're above it, we're in another state. When we're at the high level. But at that middle state, we're in that memory level where the RS flip-flop is going to maintain the state, the last state that it was at. And that's where we get that stable state where this holds it. So when that switch is not depressed, we've got a stable voltage level which is sitting at the middle, which maintains either an on or an off level out of pin 3. Now, depending on that level that we've got out here, you see we've got pin 3 which goes out and it drives our switch, which is obviously going to switch our circuit on or off. But we've also got this feedback coming down here through the circuit, back through the resistor here, which charges the capacitor. Now, if the output is switched on and that is at a high, that is going to be on high and charging up our capacitor to a voltage level which is higher than our kind of middle voltage over here. So when that's high, we get our capacitor charged up, but the V trigger doesn't see that voltage level until we depress the switch. So when you depress the switch, we then place the capacitor in circuit across the trigger. And obviously that level is higher than our kind of memory state that's being held by the voltage divider. and then the flip-flop is going to change its state from that high to a low. So we've gone through that logic before. It's going to go from the high to the low. You've now released the switch. What's happening? This has gone low. So the capacitor is no longer being charged. In fact, it's discharged to a low voltage level. So now it's lower than a third VCC, or it's lower than this kind of middle memory state, but it's not seen yet because we've obviously released the switch. When we depress the switch again, that low level across the transistor is then seen, changing the state of the flip-flop, which is going to drive this high again. We've obviously released, it's a momentary switch, so we've released the switch. We then now get this high, we switch on the circuit, and we get a current coming through and charging the capacitor back up again. So it's now ready for another depress, which is obviously going to run through that same cycle again. So once you actually trace through the circuit and have that level of understanding, it's quite easy to see how that works. But as I say, it's critical to understand that you've got that middle level of where you're in your memory state on the RS flip-flop. And then according to whether your capacitor is sitting charged, you're either sitting at the high level above 2/3 VCC, which is going to change the state of the 555 time or the RS flip-flop, or whether you've got it in its discharge state, where you're going to be presenting a low voltage level, less than a third VCC, which will again then change the state and output of your 555 timer. And that's literally how the latch switch works. So now in part two, let's go and have a look at a practical demonstration of all of that.